Tonight on Beyond the District, we see how one man's love for chicken helped a young child.
Beyond the District will be returned in 2 minutes.
But the butcher don't care, oh, if you live or if you die. But I've never touched nothing that my spirit could kill. You know I've seen a lot of people walking around with tombstones in their eyes.
Hello, I'm Julia Slevin, and welcome to TV21's Beyond the District.
And I'm Brooke Dudar. Later on tonight, we will take a look at how the winter air can affect your skin.
But up first tonight, we take a look. She wasn't expecting it, but a college student ended up raising tens of thousands of dollars for St. Jude's Children Research. It all started with a Thanksgiving tweet that went viral. Drew Reeves reports.
WSU sophomore Danny Messina got to spend a nice holiday with family. But for many families, that isn't the case, including one of Danny's close friends.
And he's like, oh, you know, like, I spent it with my grandma in the hospital. And so I'm like, wow, like, that's actually a thing that people do. Like, that's actually, like, that's so common.
So she concocted a plan, make her friends favorite and retweet her in exchange for donations to St. Jude Hospital, where many sick children have to spend their holidays. With just about 700 followers at the time she sent the tweet, there was no way to know it would go viral.
Then I tweeted out, I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna give back to St. Jude, and kind of only expecting like 50 retweets, like 100 likes maybe.
Try again. While traveling back to school from Thanksgiving break, that tweet was getting some attention. A lot of attention.
Okay, we're going up and up, and so I got here, I'm like, guys, like, what do I do?
Danny was expecting to donate around $500, but was soon on the line for $50,000, and it kept going. That's an amount no college student can afford. So Danny set up a GoFundMe to make good on her promise. Just 3 days later, she had already raised the $50,000.
I woke up, and someone texted me, Danny, you met your goal. And I literally just started crying.
But Danny isn't finished. Since she reached her goal so quickly, she's ready to see just how far she can go.
New four-legged friend.
There isn't a day that 5-year-old Riley Brett doesn't think about her best friend. His name, Chicken Nugget, and he was bite-sized just like her.
Look how cute he was.
He now rests near her heart, one with a gaping hole her mother and the community are trying to fill. Today, Riley's sadness is replaced with uncontrollable joy. Today, Riley and her mother meet Chicken Nugget's sister from New Mexico. Her name, of course, is Chicken Wing. Riley says her best friend from heaven made it happen.
I guess you could say he sent an angel to us, so she definitely has wings and made her way to us.
Volunteers drove 14 hours.
Miss Chicken Wing, someone wants to meet you.
To see this moment.
Look at her.
Of course, she remembered the joy she felt.
It sounds just like Chicken Nugget.
With her old best friend. And it didn't take very long.
She's a good pony and I like her.
For the new duo to become inseparable.
She does what I tell her to.
So I know that this is now a new best friend for her and something that she'll get to cherish and remember.
Just two best buds.
My horsey.
She's Riley's little princess and she's a little princess pony and princesses have tutus and tiaras.
Who knew a horse named Chicken Wing could bring everyone's spirit sky high?
It was worth every minute. It was worth every mile driven to just see a smile back on her face. It's the happiest I've seen her in a long time.
Whoa, Chicken Wing.
She'll get to cherish and remember and all the good people and just get to share her love again with this pony.
Come on.
A golden retriever that spent 8 days locked inside a car is headed home. Sandy was in a car with her owner, who died while driving to Florida. But workers with the Humane Society made sure she got home after going through so much. Jonathan Brannon reports.
This is Sandy. Her home is more than 500 miles away, but she found herself here at the Humane Society of South Mississippi after a tragic turn of events.
We have been really fortunate to look after this beautiful soul for the last couple of days, and we are part of her journey home.
Dawn Boob at the Humane Society says Sandy came into their care after she was found in a car on the side of the interstate. She had been trapped there for 8 days with her deceased owner. The Humane Society started reaching out looking for anyone who could claim her and help her get home. Turns out her owner was traveling home to his wife in Florida from Texas, and according to the Harrison County coroner, died of natural causes on the way.
They had one transaction where he stopped at a gas station and then his wife just never heard from him again. So it was just kind of a frantic search.
Friends of the family, Michelle Lonke and Cheryl Jenkinson, got in touch with the Humane Society and a trip was organized to pick up Sandy.
Are you ready to go home? Are you ready to go home? Oh, just such a good girl.
The pair made the trip with the help of their community in the Tampa Bay area, and now they're going back with heavy hearts, but a sense of joy in getting this girl back home. And after going through so much, I have a feeling this leg of the trip will be pretty good for Sandy.
Mom said she could have a cheeseburger on the way home too, so we're gonna make a pit stop at McDonald's. We're gonna spoil her on the way home.
In Gulfport, Jonathan Brandon.
Next, California is experiencing one of the worst wildfire seasons in state history, as strong winds and dry vegetation are helping the flames spread quickly. Kristen Holmes reports from Ventura, California.
Smoke from some wildfires in Southern California so thick it can be seen from the International Space Station, and the situation likely to get worse. Unfavorable weather conditions fueling the flames.
There's a lot of potential for some large fire growth on the north and west side of this fire in the next 24 to 48 hours.
More than 100,000 acres already scorched, and officials say containment is minimal.
This predicted wind event should last through Saturday, so we've got several days before we're out of the woods.
Emotions running high as fires wreaking havoc in Los Angeles and Ventura counties.
I don't know what I'm going to do right now. I can't think right because everything is burned down to the ground.
Here, a heroic moment as one man risks his life to save a wild rabbit from the flames on Highway 1. More than 260 public and charter schools in the Los Angeles area are closed throughout the rest of the week, and health officials advising residents to limit their time outdoors because of the smoke.
There's a deep, deep thicket of brush that didn't burn in our 2015 fire 2 years ago. When the flames hit that, it went off like a gas bomb.
Now we are going to take a short break, but coming up, we take a look at how a couple had an unfortunate accident.
And we also take a look.
My name is Emily, and in 7 years, I'll be an alcoholic.
Hi, Emily.
I'll start drinking in 8th grade, but my parents won't really notice because I'll do okay in school and everything will seem okay. But everything won't be okay.
Kids who drink before age 15 are 5 times more likely to have alcohol problems when they're adults. So start talking before they start drinking.
As a parent, I know one of the most important times to be with your children is when they aren't feeling well. That's when the love and comfort of a family is essential to a child's well-being. For many families, there's a place they can go to find the support they need.
Ronald McDonald House Charities programs provide that supportive environment so families can be together while their children are dealing with serious illnesses and undergoing treatment. It's a home away from home for families in need, giving them more time for hugs, kisses, quiet moments together.
You can volunteer your time at a local Ronald McDonald House and help a family in need by cooking a meal or hosting a movie night. You can also drop your extra change in an RMHC canister.
These contributions, both large and small, help more than 10,000 families every day. Proof that a little help goes a long way. Today is a great day for all of us to show our support and help give families in need more time together.
To find out how you can get involved in your community, visit rmhc.org.
Welcome back. A woman in Pennsylvania County, Virginia, is recovering in the hospital, and her boyfriend is dead. After they were found trapped in a car for days, authorities say the car went down a ravine after the gas pedal got stuck last week. Coulter Ansett reports.
Pennsylvania County Sheriff's Deputy Corporal Robert Grubbs was off duty yesterday when he received a call about a search underway for an elderly couple that had been missing since last Thursday.
Put my uniform on, responded to the area, was going to assist with the search.
As he was leaving the couple's home on Stony Mill Church Road after a search of the property didn't turn up any clues, he noticed something unusual across the street.
I looked across the road and I said, well, looks like a vehicle might have transversed through the weeds.
When he went to take a closer look, he saw the sunlight reflecting off the grill of a car.
At this point, I then heard somebody yell for help.
The person calling for help was Sandra Stevens. She had been trapped in the car since last Thursday. She and her boyfriend were backing out of their driveway and the gas pedal in the car got stuck. The car shot backwards down the ravine. When the car came to rest, her boyfriend got out and tried to get help, but Brosville Fire Chief Kevin Ferris said he couldn't get up the ravine.
Due to the briars and the overgrowth of the cutover, he was unable to make it.
He was found dead next to the car. The car's battery was also found dead. Ferris said Stevens had been honking the car's horn and flashing the headlights, trying to signal for help. Around 11 a.m. yesterday, help finally arrived.
She looked up and she said, is that a fire truck? And I said, yes, ma'am. She said, praise God.
In Pennsylvania County, Coulter Anstatt, 10 News, working for you.
Up next, when some Grinch stole Christmas money from a bunch of Boy Scouts, a California tattoo shop owner fixes things with a little holiday spirit. Nicole Comstock reports.
It's exhausting work.
There's many jobs to do.
Running a Christmas tree lot.
We're not just like messing around.
This one is kept up by kids who come here after school.
I am a Life Scout.
To raise money for the Elk Grove Boy Scout Troop 59.
Even before I joined the troop, I saw it around here.
The lot has been here in the same parking lot for over 30 years, which is why they think whoever stole their tip jar on Sunday night knew exactly who they were stealing it from.
Turned around and the entire jar was gone.
Committee Chair Chris Joyce says the $150 or so dollars in that jar,
money for all the boys to go to summer camp,
would have been very hard for these boys to earn back. but they didn't have to.
Hey, no problem.
Because of their neighbor, Josh Hughes, who owns Emerald Tattoo and Piercing in the same parking lot.
Hold mom's hand, Joey.
When he heard about the theft, he walked right on over and handed them a check for $200.
You know, too personal, too close.
He has kids too, and for the record, he also used to be a Boy Scout.
I was not a good Boy Scout. It didn't last very long.
My family, we have tattoos, so it's not a surprise at all.
Life Scout David Lilly wouldn't necessarily have expected this gesture from a guy with a giant beard and face tattoos.
Not really.
But then again,
would you expect someone to just steal a tip jar?
Especially from kids who operate by a code of honor.
You found the perfect tree?
To return the act of kindness, the scouts told Hughes' kids to pick out their favorite Christmas tree and take it back to their tattoo shop.
Now we take a look at a special dog that is getting a helping hand from some humans.
It's surgery day for Loka, a four-month-old female bull terrier. And just like any other hospital surgery, the patient is wheeled into surgery, hooked up to tubes and monitors. Loka will be attended by faculty members and a resident of the UC Davis Veterinary Medical Hospital's Dentistry and Oral Surgery Service. But Loka's case is not typical. It's tricky because of her injury. She was bitten by another dog so severely the right side of her skull and jaw had extensive damage. She also had multiple puncture wounds on her face and neck. But luck is on her side thanks to the development of a 3D printed mask. The Dentistry and Oral Surgery Service and the Biomedical Engineering Department have collaborated over the years to develop 3D print skull models. Loka will be the first patient to try out the Exo K9. As soon as Loka arrived at the hospital, students were ready to print the mask based on her exact specifications from a CAT scan, so it fits precisely. Developers say the mask will help in healing fractures, a lot like the way a cast helps leg fractures heal. After a 3-day hospital stay, doctors say Loka was doing well. She almost immediately began eating soft food and remained comfortable with pain medications. Doctors say the Exo K9 included a padded neck bandage to help stabilize her neck fracture. Almost 3 months after the surgery, Loka continues doing well. When the mask is removed, you can see the imprint from the mask, but the healing has begun. Loka appears happy to be up and around. Her owners grateful for the team who engineered and administered the Exo K9, giving Loka, the 3D mask puppy, a new lease on life.
It is now time for another break. Coming up later in the show, we'll take a look at
Beyond the District. We'll be right back.
At the stick, you're never gonna fit in much, kid. But if you're troubled and hurt, what you got under your shirt will make them pay for the things that they did.
When your day is long.
If you sit. Welcome back to Beyond the District. I'm Julius Levin. In today's Health Minute, Kim Hutcherson gives you some tips on how to make sure you're keeping your skin protected during the cold, dry winter months.
Cold, dry winter air can be rough on anyone's skin, especially those who suffer from psoriasis, a skin disorder in which the body's own immune system becomes overactive and attacks normal tissues. Cold air has an extraordinarily low moisture content, which can steal moisture from the skin. So be sure and protect yourself this winter by covering up when you go outdoors. Layer up and use moisturizers before you go outside. Indoors, cut down on those long, hot showers. Experts say they strip natural oils from the skin. Also, use a thick, fragrance-free body cream after showering, and make sure you're using the right soap. Switch to a moisturizing soap and ditch the scented body wash to avoid itchy winter skin. And a reminder, just because it's winter and less daylight doesn't mean you shouldn't be using sunscreen. For today's Health Minute, I'm Kim Hutcherson.
Next, among the nominees for the 2018 Grammy Awards is a blind fiddler from Kentucky. His most recent album is nominated for the Best Bluegrass Album. He shares with reporter Shannon Kogan.
This is called Fiddle Rising. Kind of makes the bow hair grab the strings.
This song is the first time Michael Cleveland ever heard the fiddle. It's called Orange Blossom Special. At the time, Michael was just 4 years old.
That song just captivated me for some reason. And from that moment on, I knew I had to learn how to play the fiddle. Most people I know just don't remember anything about when they were 4 years old, but I'll never forget that.
But Michael couldn't read music. He was born blind.
Most people that I know of, you know, their teachers tell them to practice in a dark room. And, you know, you shouldn't look at things. You should listen to things when it comes to playing.
During the week at the Kentucky School for the Blind, he took classical lessons. On the weekends?
Yeah, that was the very, very first contest he ever played in.
It's terrible.
It was all about bluegrass.
I listened to bluegrass, I played bluegrass, I dreamed about playing bluegrass nonstop. That's all I've ever wanted to do.
After high school, Michael joined a band, played at the Grand Ole Opry, even with Vince Gill, and is now the band leader of Michael Cleveland and Flamekeeper. All this time, he's been recording solo albums. It's his latest one that has made Michael a Grammy nominee for Best Bluegrass Album at the age of 37.
I think, oh my God, was the first thing out of my mouth after I recovered.
It's been 33 years since he started playing. So it's a lot of hard work, but it's great.
For Michael, the title track, Fiddler's Dream, couldn't be more perfect.
A Texas man headed to buy some fast food found an abandoned baby on the way. Chancey Clover has the story.
I saw this baby seat sitting in the middle of the parking lot and thought it looked a little odd.
Stephen Ward called police and then snapped this photo. He posted it to Facebook, leaving everyone to wonder how in the world did this baby girl end up in the middle of a parking lot all alone.
I was shocked.
Here's the backstory. Galveston police say mom and dad came to this washateria on Broadway Monday night around 7 o'clock.
They were unloading at that time and making trips back and forth from the vehicle.
And in the blink of an eye,
someone jumped in the car and took off.
The family's car with the 4-month-old baby girl inside, gone. Minutes later,
the perpetrator realized that there was a child in the back seat, found a well-lit area to place the child.
Right here in the parking lot of this church.
Fine, yeah.
And then comes along Stephen Ward, who for some reason says he had a sudden taste for some church's chicken, which is right next door to the church.
I almost didn't go down that way. I almost just went straight home. And I just something told me to go down there.
And thankfully he did. It was dark and slightly cold when he noticed the car seat on the ground.
Maybe had a blanket on and had a bottle, and he was just content, sitting in the parking lot.
Stephen called police, and the mystery baby was reunited with her parents.
They just happened to be in the right place at the right time, I guess.
Tonight, the car and the suspect still nowhere to be found. but the baby is safe.
While we understand that household chores can be taxing, we would caution you against leaving your child in a car, even momentarily, because things like this can happen.
The real hero here is Church's chicken, because I, if it wasn't for those honey biscuits, I probably wouldn't even went down that way. Probably went home and ate.
Wrapping up tonight's show, a young woman was saved from a burning car after a violent crash. In Maine, Brad Rogers spoke to the woman recovering from her injuries. She wants to thank the two men who saved her.
Stopping, thank you for checking.
Alicia Zostak is bruised and hurting all over, but she says she owes her life to the men who rescued her.
Just caring and your quick response and getting me out of there and safe.
Shortly after midnight, Alicia Zostak was driving south on Route 35 in Naples when she spotted a deer in the road.
I just remember reacting and jerking the wheel as hard as I could and then trying to overcorrect again. And I remember feeling it go up on two wheels.
She hit two trees and the vehicle ended up on its side. She says her legs felt like jello and she was trapped in the car.
And then I see the glow of the fire start. And I'm trying to get out of there.
She says the car stopped, and she heard two men talking about how to get her out.
There was a lady, young lady in the vehicle that was hollering for help.
Irvin Ward was one of those two men. The sheriff's office says the other is an unknown Good Samaritan.
We got the back door open to her car. He went inside in the back seat and helped put the front seat back and helped her get unlatched.
Next thing I know, they're just pulling me right out of there.
As she was being pulled out, she was looking at the car and it was on fire.
Alicia and her husband say those two men saved her life.
Truly from the bottom of my heart, you know, I have my wife here because of them. And there's no words for that.
I don't think I would be alive if it wasn't for them.
It's just, you know, something anybody would do.
Remember, if you have a story you would like us to cover,
or if you have an announcement about an upcoming event, please send it interschool mail to the TV21 studio at High School East, or you can email us at tv21@trsschools.com. Also, be sure to tune in TV21 through the day to watch the show and Tom's River Schools Today, as we bring you stories from around the district. Also, please take a look at our website, www.trsschools.com/TV21.
Well, that wraps up tonight's show. For Beyond the District, I'm Julius Levin.
And I'm Brooke Dudar. Have a great night.